Good afternoon. My name is Donna Lucas, and on behalf of the Public Policy Institute of California's Board of Directors, I'm happy to welcome you all here today. We are pleased to present this program featuring United States Senator Dianne Feinstein in conversation with PPIC's President Mark Baldassare. Senator, thank you for being here today. This event is part of PPIC's 2017 speaker series on California's future. We'd like to thank our sponsors who so generously give so we can do this and provide a wonderful lunch for everyone. Their names are listed over here on the screen and also on the back of your programs. In addition, I'd like to thank the PPIC donor circle and the PPIC corporate donor circle who also contribute to bringing these phenomenal events to us, both in person and online. But before we begin, just a few housekeeping items. As you know, at PPIC, we love doing surveys, so you'll get one later today to ask you about the program. Please give us your feedback. We're always trying to improve. And also take a moment to silence your phones so that we can have an uninterrupted program. So with that, I'm gonna turn this over to Mark. Thank you, Mark, and thank you, Senator Feinstein.
Thank you very much, Donna, and thanks to everybody for being here today, especially Senator Feinstein. And yes,
the mics.
The mics will. Somebody will turn them on, and I'll in the meantime speak up. I don't think there's anything I can. No, it's on for me. Okay, good. Let me just mention a couple of things because there are a lot of new faces in the audience. A lot of people with terrific signs. That can you just bring up your signs for a moment? We can all take a look at them. Good, fabulous. Well, thank you. I just want to make a comment about the signs. My wife Cheryl and I are my wife Cheryl's here today, and we were in New York on at Columbus Circle on President's Day, and I think that the, wouldn't you agree, the West Coast signs much better than the East Coast signs?
Yeah.
Yeah. So thank you for your energy and for your interest in being here. And I want to speak for a moment, if you could put down your signs now, if you wouldn't mind, so our friends in the back can see unobstructed, about it, how we got to doing this program today. It's part of our speaker series, which this is the third event that we've had this year. Right after the election, I sent a letter to Senator Feinstein, Senator-elect Harris, Congresswoman Pelosi, and Congressman McCarthy, the leaders from our point of view, the leaders, and asked them to participate in our speaker series program this year. And there's one person who I got a response from, Senator Feinstein. So if the others are listening, we want to do a program with you too sometime. And our programs are a conversation and with an opportunity for the audience to ask questions towards the end. And I will definitely be interested, and I know the senator will be, in taking some questions from you. When I heard from the senator's staff 2 weeks ago, of course, we were very excited to do this, and we're very pleased that, you know, and honored with the opportunity to have a conversation with the senator. We recognize this is a time when there are, you know, just everybody has great questions for their leaders, and it was the senator's staff suggested that we change up our format a little bit and ask our online for submitted questions. And so I have a list of questions which I've actually spent hours poring through. I'm, you know, very interested in what questions people have. And they're gonna help guide our conversation today. Many of the questions were similar to things that I had on my mind, but some of them were different. And others, you know, there are other things that I thought were important that I wanna capture in this conversation. But I want to start out with a very general question for Senator Feinstein. And that is that I think that all of us are very interested in how you're thinking about your role as Senator for California at this time of, shall we say, emerging challenges in federal-state relations.
Well, thank you, Mark, and it's good to be here. I know I've done this before, and I'm very pleased I was able to do it again. For those of you that saw me limp in, I've done something to my knee, and it is not without a lot of pain, so please excuse the feeble entry. I think we're in an unprecedented time. I've been doing what I do for a long time. I was mayor of this great city for 9 years, and I've been the senator for the largest state in the union for 24. We actually are bigger in population than 22 states and the District of Columbia put together. So you can figure out the numbers of people. Today, California is over 40 million people. We are a very large economic engine. We are unfortunately a high-cost state. We've had a tendency to bleed some jobs because of that cost. And so many of us are looking at things anew. In the Senate, you sort of proceed by seniority. There are generally two kinds of people, workhorses and show horses. And I decide some time ago that I wanted to try and be a workhorse. So I've taken very seriously what I've done. I now am the lead Democrat on the Judiciary Committee, which gives me a couple of assets to work with. One, some new staff. Two, the ability to participate in some of the big confirmation hearings, the biggest of which is coming up, and that's the Supreme Court. I spent 6 years as chairman of the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, then its vice chair, and now I am just a member. But during that time, we were able to put out a torture report, which took 6 years to do, is 7,000 pages long, 32,000 footnotes, which very clearly shows how torture is ineffective. It doesn't meet our values. And what was done right after 9/11 was more brutal than anybody ever thought. There is a summary that's been published, and I'd like to commend it to you. It's 450 pages, but it's a read you won't forget. So right now, here we are, outnumbered, outvoted, in the West, fairly liberal, really concerned with openness and privacy and moving things ahead and educating people, and coming up against a government, who knows? A lot of epithets. The president seems to shoot from the hips. Conventional policy seems out of the ordinary. Conflict of interest looks like it's real. Major problems with Russia interfering in our election. And I'm getting little signals. Are the Greens good? If I get a green one, is that good? Yeah. Oh, okay. That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, and Senator, I just want
barometer.
You to know, it's not a PPIC survey, but it's, I guess, representative of the audience here today at the forum. Yeah.
So let me just tell you what my big issues are. Number one for California has been water. Now this year, it's land subsidence. We have a huge problem throughout the whole center of our state, which in the last 2 years, land has dropped 2 feet. Aqueducts are cracked, roads are cracked. The California aqueduct today carries 20% less water because of it. So many people, over 40 million. So I plan to address. A second thing for me are nuclear weapons. I've been chair, and I'm now ranking, of the Energy and Water Subcommittee of Appropriations. And I'm old enough to have seen the bomb that went off at Hiroshima and the bomb that went off at Nagasaki. And let's say the first was that these numbers are classified, so I'm making them up in the vicinity. Say 17 to 20 kilotons, and the second maybe 7 to 10 kilotons. 200,000 people killed outright. And we have forgotten what it's like. I'm from the generation where we dropped under our desks to prepare ourselves. That doesn't work anymore. So to hear the president say that, you know, he thinks, well, nuclear weapons are better if we don't have them, but if we have them, we're going to be at the top of the pack. That's absolutely wrong. And so I have a whole area of what to do with nuclear weapons. We store our nuclear waste all over the country. It is extraordinarily dangerous. We are working to get a site. We've got one in New Mexico. We need to expand on it. So those are some of the technical things that I work on. Just so you know, I have a staff of about 80. We run 4 offices in California. We have probably had more than 1 million phone calls over these nominees. And so, yes, you've done your job. You know, we tell people, let's do our job. You've done your job. We know. What I have taken to doing in evaluating them is carefully evaluating them. The national security nominees are one thing. The Mattises, defense, Kelly, intelligence. I need to work with whomever is director of intelligence, and I believe I can. Others, I have voted no on when I don't believe they're credentialed. I don't believe they're right for this country at this time, and that will continue on with no votes. The problem is, we don't win these battles. So the key for me is to figure out how we can begin to win some of these battles. We are looking at conflict of interest, which I think this president has substantial guilt about. I don't believe that a son should, on the public payroll, go to Uruguay to do a hotel opening that makes money for the company that his father owns. And so we are now beginning to track these, and we will be proposing a resolution of non-acceptance, which will begin, we hope, a real look into conflict of interest. Let me just quickly speak about one of the most dangerous things that's happened. And it is Russia beginning to use what we call highly secret work in the area of hacking to interfere in political campaigns, not only with us, but with other countries, and particularly European countries and Eastern European countries. But this was a covert information-driven program. And I have access to all of the secure papers. I've read them all, and then there's one paper that isn't secure that I can talk about. And it's the agreement of all of the intelligence agencies of our country. And that is that Russia went into both campaigns, but particularly on the Democratic side, with the view of preventing the election of the Democratic candidate. And in the event they could not, to diminish her as much as they possibly could. And that was I believe, an effective campaign. It's reprehensible. It's got to stop. And so there is a very large investigation going on. And the beauty of having intelligence do some of this is because this is our natural oversight area. And so we don't have to go to the Congress with a resolution that says, please, Mother, may I? And it takes 3 months to get through. This has already started. Our chairman, Richard Burr, and our ranking member now, who is Mark Warner from Virginia, have done a very good job in putting together a roadmap of how this review is going to take place. And you can be absolutely sure that we are dedicated to do this and let the facts come out and fall where they may. It is so important that this never happen again. That's the first thing. So let me stop now. Yes. And
thank you.
I gave you some things.
Yes.
You get
I think
the specific as you want.
Some good context.
Mark.
I'm looking through some of the questions that were asked in advance by your constituents, our Californians, a number of them asking about the appointment process of cabinet members, something you've already addressed. But then several people also had questions about where you stand on the SCOTUS nominee, Gorsuch.
The POTUS nominee? The President of the United States.
No.
But which one?
Well, it's SCOTUS, a Supreme Court nominee.
The Supreme Court.
Yeah.
I have met with Mr. Gorsuch, and we had a good conversation. Different senators have different rules. I generally don't, does that mean you disagree with my meeting or you disagree with Gorsuch? In any event, we had a good meeting. There are a couple of things that I am very interested in, and I talked to my staff this morning. I did the first assault weapons legislation, which became law, in 1993. And I believe to the top from the bottom of me that weapons of war don't belong on the streets of our city. I remember when I was as young as many of you in this room, it was 1968, and I saw somebody stand up in the Texas Bell Tower and just begin shooting people down below. And I thought, oh my God, what is this? I never saw it before. And then it became commonplace. And we saw workplaces invaded. We saw schools invaded. We saw people at a movie theater shot. We see the evolution of weapons of war, the AR-15, the M-16 alternative. We see a 50 caliber rifle, which you can buy, which will send a bullet miles away, a sniper rifle, and go through brick. These weapons don't belong on our streets, in our schools. And I think for many of us, Sandy Hook was the clincher. One of the New York newspapers, and I have this in my study in Washington, has the 20 faces of the children on the cover. And across it, it says, for shame. And that's really right. For shame on us not to be able to do anything about it. Well, we have a case now, I think it's the Fourth Circuit, which says that these weapons of war, 10 or more, more than 10 bullets in a clip, do not have Second Amendment protection. First time. So we will go back once again with a bill that meets all of those confines, which came from the Heller division, Heller decision, that you can, in fact, tailor something which does not have Second Amendment protection. Please, please help with this. This will be a mighty fight. Could one person at a time?
Excuse me. I'm the questioner, and please, No shouting out from the audience. This is not not appropriate for PPIC event. So that's my job to make sure that she answers the question. So we have to have, this is a civil discourse, and it's very important that we keep it at that. So I would ask again.
Where I'm going with this, yes, on this nominee is I will make the first remarks on the Democratic side. And this will be part of my remarks. And the second thing that I will talk about is reproductive choice. It's control of our own bodies. I'm old enough that when I was in college, I saw young girls go to Tijuana at somebody who was at my school who killed herself. I sat on the women's prison board. I sentenced people, women who committed abortions. I saw the harm that was done. And many of you who are young, particularly women, take so much for granted. Don't. We could go back to those days, and we must not. And this justice in both of these things, guns and a woman's ability to control her own reproductive system, are two of the most important things that will change, in my view, based on this individual. I don't announce what I'm going to do before the hearing. I don't think that's right. So we will probably have 3 to 4 days straight of hearings. And then I will certainly announce it, and others will as well. This is the biggest hearing that we do. It is also affected by the way the Republicans candidly treated a candidate that I was one of those that recommended them to the White House. His name was Merrick Garland. He was 22 years on the District Court of Appeals for the D.C. District, chief judge, well-respected, supervised the prosecution of the Oklahoma City bombers. I thought that he would be somebody that both Republicans and Democrats could agree to. Well, what happened was that a precedent has been established that now the President of the United States, in his fourth year, loses his opportunity to make an appointment. That's terrible. Never happened before. So Merrick Garland, to a great extent, I was debating whether to use this word, but it sticks in our craw. And it's very hard to accept. So this is going to be, I think, a very full, I hope a very fair, and I hope a very grounded hearing that will go on for several days, and then we'll make a decision.
Thank you. And I think that in answering the question, you really gave us a sense about, what it will take to determine your vote in terms of where you see the priorities. I want to go back to an issue that you had addressed earlier. I think, and this really has to do with what's changed in Washington. In the year since we last spoke, because we spoke in March, and I don't know how many people in the audience have been in Washington in this year in 2017. Not many of us, right? I was there for a day. Tell us what it's like. What's your impression of the new president, the administration? We need to know firsthand what the situation is, and we hope this is one of the things you can tell us today. I picked that up in a lot of the questions that came in.
Well, let me begin. This is unlike any other presidency. There's no question about it. I have met him once in the Oval Office. He was very personal, very personable, very easy to talk to, which kind of surprised me. But you can't just go with what's on the top of your head all the time. And these weeks have put this great country in a very divided stance with so much fear of people, because nobody, A, knows what's coming next. B, he says it's going to be a military operation to deport people. And then General Kelly, head of Homeland Security, comes on and says, we're not going to use any military. Well, this is an administration that's at sixes and sevens with itself. You ought to know what you're going to do before you announce one of these. So we have had this line of memoranda and executive orders, which have been, to a great extent, poorly thought out, pushed out quickly, terrifies lots of people, and many of them probably won't stand either a court test or a test of time, but we'll see. And what it's like, and I guess some people like it, it's government from the first thing that comes into your mind, you say, you're going to do. And we all know he's president, but he keeps having to promote that campaign. He keeps having to say how big he is, how good he is, how he's going to do this or he's going to do that, when you sit down with your allies and you make lots of mistakes right off the bat. And this is deeply concerning, because we've got real problems out there. We've got real problems with North Korea. North Korea is probably within 5 years of a ballistic missile that can carry a warhead and hit the United States, carry a nuclear warhead and hit the United States, with a leader that no one has met with a country that is very deprived, and with a big, powerful neighbor, China, who doesn't do much about it. So there's that. There's Russia, whether Russia's going to continue to be an expansionist country. It took Crimea. It took part of Ukraine back. It's resistive to the NATO nations. There is a great deal of insecurity in our allies. Where will we be? Where will we stand? Will we be helpful to them? Will we stand up? And these are all things that a president needs to project. And I keep hoping that after this month, and maybe one more month, things will settle down. And you can kind of go to regular order. Yes, thank you very much. That's really important. Thank you. Oh, disagree. You don't want them to settle down. Okay. Okay. Well, here's the thing.
Excuse me, if I might once again say, you know, this is, please give our speaker a chance to speak. And
okay.
And, you know.
I kind of enjoy it, but I'll sit back. In any event.
Okay.
In any event. Yeah, well, maybe we'll work that out. Okay? Yeah.
Okay, so I have many questions that have come in that I'd like to get to, and we're not going to get to any of them if we have a lot of interruptions. So,
oh, you're tough, Mark.
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I think that there's you raise the issue of fear, and you spoke out when there were the stepped-up immigration raids, and you issued a statement against them. Since then there have been new directives just recently on deportation. There are travel bans.
Yeah.
This California is a state that is built on immigration, which many people who live in this state now are living in fear.
That That's just what I'm trying to say.
I would
That's
like
right.
to really get a sense from you, and I think that I picked this up in other comments from others. What in your role are you doing around the issue
well,
of immigration?
There are specific things we can do, and the first is protecting the DACA children. And these are the dreamers who are in this country. We actually have, it's estimated, around 40% of them, 370,000 of them. And we are determined to do that. He touches that, and the lid comes off, I think, in the Congress. Because these are children that were brought here through no fault of their own. And what's amazing, ladies and gentlemen, is how they are succeeding. It's, you know, and their determination. I have followed some of them. I've also seen where immigration has gone in the middle of the night and taken the mother and father and left three children. This is a San Diego case that I've followed. And it's got to stop. So there are ways, but it's hard when you've got a president that's ordering this. But I think we let our views be known and known very clearly. And I think in this state, we are very lucky. I do not know a county leader, a city mayor, that is not strong on the protection of immigrants, that does not believe that this country is made from immigrants. I mean, my mother came here from Russia as a child, four small children. My grandfather, stowed away on a ship from Poland, made shoes in Boston, worked his way out, had 11 children here. My father was lucky enough to become a professor at the University of California Medical Center. This is our life. This is our history. And all of us have had families that have come from somewhere else. And I loved it when someone got that sign up on the Statue of Liberty. Refugees welcome. That's America.
Another topic that's creating a lot of fear right now is the repeal of the Affordable Care Act. As you know, and PPIC has done work on this topic, millions of people have signed up through either the insurance exchange or through the expansion of Medi-Cal. And those are millions of people who didn't have health insurance before, who are now concerned that they're not going to have health insurance going forward. So I'm wondering, what can you do to protect
well,
the health care
Well, I'll tell
California?
You, first of all, I can vote against it. Second of all, there are amendments that need to be made. We have looked carefully at people that call us. Everything is computerized, mm-hmm. so we know everything that people say. And a big problem, in my view, is the individual program part. That's the single person that buys their own plan separate from business. And I hope I get these numbers right, but there are about 2.1 million, and there are a million that have the subsidy. Now, I had Peter Lee, the head of Covered California, in, and what he said is the subsidy ends at the salary of $47,000 a year. So you could make $50,000 a year and be 60 years old and have to pay $800 a month. That's a number he gave me for a premium. And then that premium can go up 5% next year, 8% the following year, 4% the third year. It all compounds. So we have to find a way to deal with that individual marketplace. And we're looking at a couple of things. We're looking at expanding the marketplace. Right now, every marketplace is just a single state. Well, if you made them bigger, would that make a difference? Secondly, if you eliminated the cliff that people fall off, like you're protected up to $47,000 a year, Then you go $47,900 and you get nothing and your premium zooms up. That's not so easy because it's very expensive. It's about $20 billion over 10 years. And so what we're trying to do, and this is sort of my little piece of it, is how can we do this? How can we stabilize this marketplace, eliminate the cliff, and see that people, when they get to be age 50 or 60, can afford an individual plan? Some people retire, their health care doesn't come with them, they go in the individual market, and then they get socked. And that's where most of our complaints have come from.
Thank you. Another question, and several people voiced concerns about environmental issues, and I just want to mention this one. I thought it was nicely put. How is the government going to protect clean air and water without an environmental proponent in charge of the EPA?
Well, that's a real problem.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't conceive. Thank you for the agree. I can't conceive of somebody being head of EPA that is opposed to EPA. Mm-hmm. And I would submit to this group here that this is one of the most important areas of human endeavor. We are killing our planet Earth. Global warming is real. It is happening. I just met yesterday with one of the great experts, and he said to me, it's already too late to keep it within 2% Celsius. The common knowledge has been that if you can keep the warming within 2 degrees Celsius and prevent it from going to 4 to 9 degrees Celsius, you can save the planet. If it goes to the latter, we're dead. And how can we do this to our grandchildren? So global warming has to be met. And we've tried three times on the floor with a bill in my 24 years. I think the most the bill has ever gotten in votes is, say, max 37 votes. It's not good enough. And this is where people like yourselves really have to make a big stand. There should be marches on do something about the warming of the climate. We've got big fissures of ice in Antarctica and up north that are about to break off. Huge, huge pieces of ice. And there are parts that were frozen that are no longer frozen. I predict, having lived in this state a long time, watched it for a long time, that California could become a desert state. If we don't have the Sierra Nevada snowfall, we're weaned off the Colorado River, most of it. Where are we going to get our water? How are we going to keep our land green? How are we going to be the number one ag state in the Union? And one good thing happened, and that was Hetch Hetchy, that we have a clean, pure source of water by gravity feed down to our city, which is the cleanest, purest water in the state of California. We must not let that be compromised. We must stay with it and protect it. And we also must see that we pass some global warming legislation. I think President Obama is really to be complimented for the Paris Agreement. He's got all our allies on our side in this. Now, what Trump should do is take this and move to the next step. Look at alternatives. Select the one that's best and become a real force for climate control. Absent that, we destroy our planet.
Thank you. Thanks. It was a concern raised by a number of people. I want to ask you a question about infrastructure. The Trump administration has talked about a $1 trillion infrastructure plan. We had state and local elected officials 2 weeks ago in Sacramento, and they talked about the potential of some federal support for infrastructure. One of the comments that came in from one of your constituents, our Californian, said, "Will you fight to get federal dollars for our high-speed rail project in California?"
Yes. Right now, we've got a huge problem there. And a group of Republican House members have written to the Secretary of Transportation opposing the electrification and modernization of Caltrain. And they did this because they don't want high-speed rail down the valley. I really need help with this. I've talked to the Secretary three times. Last time was the day before yesterday. And we need management and budget to put this in the president's budget. It's Caltrain. Caltrain is over 100 years old.
Excuse me, is this the Secretary of Transportation?
Elaine Chao. It moves 60,000 workers between Silicon Valley and San Francisco. And in a new study, believe it or not, San Francisco is the fourth most trafficked city in the world. So, and if you've tried to go anywhere recently, you know it takes like four times longer than you think it will. So we are trying to get Caltrain back on. It's really important. With respect to high-speed rail, what I am told is the state does not need any more money at the present time to move ahead with it. But there's a very strong Republican group, particularly in the Central Valley, that wants to stop it at all costs, and we have to fight that. Sorry, I'm... Well, find out who they are. Start a big letter-writing campaign. Write op-eds to the Fresno Bee. Ask them to put it in their Modesto and other versions. Get the word out.
Let me follow up with the question that the audience asked with a question that came in online. Because I think a lot of people are wondering and looking to you for some guidance today as to how they can most effectively express themselves in these times. So one of the comments that came in, California is a net contributor to the federal government.
Is what to the federal?
Net contributor.
Yes, that's right.
Is there any way to leverage its economic power to push back against policy and regulatory changes that will harm the interests of the state?
Okay, this is an interesting point. I forget the number, but it's either 94 or 96%. We overpay what we get back in federal money. And so we've been able to use that to be helpful for us. I'm an appropriator, so it's important for me to do this. The problem is, you've heard of ABC, anywhere but California. We're bigger than 22 states. Those small states say, well, let's all get together and we'll oppose California's grant for X, Y, or Z. And if you figure, well, we have two votes in the Senate, that's all, it becomes very difficult. Mm-hmm. So once, now Senator Boxer had progressed up to where she was chair and ranking of important committees. I have two, and then you kind of change that dynamic because you're in a position where the bills are put together and you can better protect, but only within your sphere of assignment, so to speak.
Another comment related to that that came in, how can California work horizontally with other states on issues of long-range importance where the administration is bent on doing harm, like global warming, protecting the environment? And I'd like you to address that issue from a Washington perspective in terms of how you work with other senators from other states. Given, again, we're a divided country, right? And there are states that have leaders with points of view like ours and states that don't.
Well, I'll tell you what I believe, and most you'll get the disagree card will come up, but it's but it's what I believe, see, we're a two-party system, and we're unlike any other democracy. I'm not a lawyer, but I've had 24 years now of looking at the Constitution, and it's an amazing document. And it gives us rights that no other nation really provides. It has a check and balance in how it sets up the three branches of government, and it's got an executive, a legislative branch, which can be very strong, and a judicial branch to oversee it. So we have a good mechanism for government. Where there's a dirty word, it's compromise. Nobody wants to compromise. But if you're a two-party system, and you're the Republican, Mark, and I'm the Democrat, and we're looking at a problem, I'm the committee chair,
And
you're the ranking member,
okay. And
I want to solve a problem. I will say to you, what do you need to get this done? And you will say to me, well, let me think about it. I'll get back to you. And you'll get back to me, and you'll say, well, I need this, that, or the other thing. And I'll say, oh, boy, you know, I think I could do one of those. Would that be helpful? And it would be a beginning of a coming together. So I go there as a Democrat to sit down with you as Republicans. I've done that on intelligence, both with the senator from Georgia, as well as the senator from North Carolina. I do it with Lamar Alexander, who's now my chairman on energy and water appropriations. I have a very good relationship with the chairman of the Judiciary Committee. I'm ranking, which is Senator Grassley. And so we talk. And I will respect those conversations. And I know where I want to go. And I know I want to get as close as I can to where I want to go. So without compromising anything that's major, how can I affect a resolution? On the Intelligence Committee, before I became chair, we didn't have an intelligence bill passed out for 5 years because nobody could agree. I did 6 years, every year, an authorization bill, because I sat down with the Republican chairman and we went over it and we put it together and we got it done. That, in my view, is the way things are supposed to happen. Now, some are cataclysmic. Some you can't do that with. I admit that. But when we're legislators, you know, you make a speech because you have to, but the work is legislative craftsmanship. It's knowing what you're doing. It's being able to put bills together that you think you can get through. It's timing. It's opportunity. When those two things run together, you can get something done. Like I'm hoping with assault weapons, with this new case out of Maryland, that the timing and the opportunity may come together. So you wait for that to happen. That's what's exciting about what we do, because you have to figure out how you can do it and get it done. And then when you do, some things I've worked on for 15 years. I'll give you an example. Olympia Snow and I began to work on corporate average fuel efficiency. That's mileage. Maybe 12 years ago, 14 years ago, we did one bill which was bringing the mileage of SUVs down to sedans. We didn't get anywhere after years. We did another bill, which is called 10 over 10, that for the first 10 years, we would have an increase in mileage savings of 10 miles. Now we're looking at, by 2025, I think it is, mileage will be 54 miles a gallon for what's called CAFE, Corporate Average Fuel Efficiency. And the way it got done was in the Commerce Committee when Senator Stevens from Alaska was the chair, and Dan Inouye from Hawaii, good friend, and they just put it in the bill. And it went through the Senate, and it went through the House, and so something that I began in 1993 took almost 20 years to get done, but it's done now, and the second part of it is based on science. So, and this is the exciting part, because if the science is there, and you can use clean fuels, and you can have good engines, all of that, then you must do it. If science says you can do it, you must do it. And I'll hazard a guess that when we get to 54 miles per gallon, and we will get there, very few other nations will be there.
Thank you. I have just one more question, and then we're going to go to the audience questions. I noticed that you have a campaign fundraiser in Los Angeles on March 17th, and I'm wondering if you're running for re-election.
Oh, well, thank you. I'm not going to announce here.
Oh.
No. But when the time comes, I will most likely announce.
Oh.
How's that?
How does that fit with the agree-disagree signs? I think we'll go to the audience questions now. And I want to, first of all, thank Senator Feinstein. But I want to thank all of you for your, for your patience and being here today and your politeness around this. So maybe we'll take a question from this side first.
The blue shirt? Who wanted to ask?
In the blue shirt. And there's one thing about, before we start questions, there's one thing I want to say about questions. Questions are questions at PPIC. They're not statements. So brief question for the senator. The more brief questions, the more we can ask.
Oh, he's got it all written down.
Okay.
I'm in trouble.
No, you're fine. Thank you so much for being here today. You've been on recess here this week, and we're very thankful that you have allowed those of us in this room this 10-minute opportunity to ask you a few questions. When you're in Washington, we need you to be our voice. But when you're here, we need you to listen to us. And we've met with your staff, we've called, but it's still clear that you're not really hearing us. The insulation your staff provides prevents you from really empathizing with us. And we need more access to you directly for you to hear us. Will you commit to change your plans and attend the town hall being held for you in Oakland this Sunday? And will you commit to spend your next recess holding a series of town halls where you devote your time to listening rather than speaking?
I am returning to Washington Sunday, so it's not possible to do that. With respect to another town hall, I have a constituent breakfast. They begin again in March. But they're in Washington. We usually get a couple of hundred people. No, I heard you. I will try to do it based on my schedule. I'm surprised that you say that. I pretty much know how people feel, but maybe I don't know exactly how you feel. So I should provide somehow, some way, that opportunity, and I will.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your question. So let's take a question from the middle somewhere. Wait for the microphone, because we're being live webcast, so we want to make sure.
There's a rumor that Trump is going to be cleaning out the CIA and FBI and only leaving his loyalists. So I'm very concerned about the intelligence being able to be our oversight. Do you have any information about that?
I do not believe, I've not heard it, and I do not believe he'd be able to do it. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't worry about it. Okay. And some of us will fight to the death to prevent that from happening. Okay. So don't.
Thank you. Let's take a question from this side now. How about in the front? And, we'll hopefully circle back again. And I also want to go out to the other room. People have been, I see your hand up there. So I'll walk out.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you for being here, Senator. Earlier in the session, you mentioned the importance of science and climate change. I'm wondering, How will you convince the Trump administration? Many of their backers do not believe in science. And
I'm missing that. How will I?
Will you convince the Trump administration?
Many
about the
in the Trump administration and his supporters, the Republican supporters, do not believe in science or deny science. How will you convince them? Apparently, there is an opportunity now with a set of Republicans who actually support a carbon tax. Will you be able to work with that? What is your position on that?
Well, the answer is yes, because I have a bill to do that. And we introduced it last session. It didn't go anywhere. We may make some changes in it and reintroduce it this session. So the answer to your question is going to be really hard. My experience is the biggest thing out there is weather changing. I've lived here. I'm older than most of you. I won't tell you how old. I've lived here all my life. I have never seen a funnel cloud in the Pacific. We see them today. I've never seen the kind of hurricanes and tornadoes that we're having today. The adversity in weather that's coming up. Climate change, when it rains, the drops are bigger. The hail is bigger. The damage is more. And so I think science, backed up by these weather changes, is increasing evidence. I mean, there's no good science that says we're not facing climate change. None.
Question right here, and then we'll go to the middle. And I do want to go to the other room, too.
Hi, Senator. I'm here with Indivisible SF. There's several of us here, by the way. Indivisible SF. I'm here with Indivisible SF, and there's several of us here.
Oh, right, yes.
We're here to resist the Trump agenda. One of the things that has come up very recently and a couple of hours ago is the attack on press freedom. Apparently, he's barred the CNN, BBC.
Can you belt it out a little bit?
He has barred CNN, the BBC, the LA Times, and who else? New York Times from the White House briefing room. And so we're very concerned about his attacks on the freedom of the press. We know that the pen is mightier than the sword, and it's appalling to me that Republicans are more concerned about gun control than freedom of speech.
Okay.
Well, so, if I know anything about the American press, what Trump is doing will not work. They will not stop doing what they're doing, because everybody, whether I agree with the reporter or the reporter agrees with me, everybody believes in the free press. And that's what makes us so different from Russia or from any other place. China, for example, no free press. That the free press is a measurement standard of our democracy. And we must keep it. And I believe that he's going to fail in trying to muzzle the press. And this fake news stuff, I mean, it sort of boils your blood. So time's going to go on. And sure, there are articles that are wrong. None of us in this life like everything that's printed about us. But this is the way life is. But the value of having, and let me tell you something else, and I can tell you this in the intelligence world, of those people that report on intelligence, they are very good. They know what they're doing. They are very serious about it. And the big newspapers have some of the finest reporters. The same thing in columnists. I mean, you can pick up, we take four newspapers, and I read them all in the morning. All my staff is online, but I like the feel of the newsprint and folding the newspaper and tearing out an article. And I think I kind of drive them crazy with that. But it's a big deal. It's a big deal, and we should support it everywhere.
Senator, we're at 1 o'clock, and I'm wondering if we might have another 10 minutes of your time. Thank you. So this is something I learned today from the senator about how to negotiate with legislators and things. I want to go out and find some of our friends in there and ask them to, and then I'll come back to you too. I got 10 more minutes for us, folks.
Do you want to ask Sean to find out if CNN is
yes,
okay?
Yes, come on out. Yeah. Question?
Stand here.
Yeah. Okay, here we go. Yeah.
Hi. I just wanted to say, first of all, thank you. You're incredibly.
You think you could come forward?
Yeah. Sure.
I'm having trouble hearing.
Yeah, this is good. Right.
Thank you.
Unless you want to go on stage with us.
First of all, thank you for coming. And thank you as a woman in a tech industry. It's really inspirational to see women like you who have been in male-dominated industries and become leaders. So thank you. I'm also from Indivisible SF. This is the first time I've really been deeply politically involved.
Standing or?
Oh.
We haven't gotten to the question yet. So, yes, question? Question.
I feel afraid of what Bannon is doing. Can you talk about what you're doing or if there's anything you can do to help remove his security clearance?
Yeah. Thank you.
Everything, this is hard to say because I am not generally like this, but Bannon is a real danger because there's a fanaticism attached to it. And this alt-right movement is extraordinarily dangerous. Take a look at what it precipitates now in the destruction of Jewish graves outside of St. Louis, of the uptick in attacks on gays and minorities.
Want to get as many in as possible. Okay.
The alt-right, to me, is an effort to carve out this small part of America and make it dominant.
Yes, ma'am.
And we must not let that happen.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
Unfortunately, there isn't much I can do about it, and this is where the press comes in.
Yeah.
The press researches, the press investigates, the press reports. So he is now a very prominent person. Let's see what he does. And let's see, well, we're now knowing some of it. Well, so what okay, geniuses, wait a minute, all the red card geniuses. Ban into Russia. Okay, well, it's a nice thought. It's a nice thought.
Another question, Judy.
Senator Feinstein, who do you support for DNC chair and why?
Oh, right now,
thank you.
I don't really support anybody for DNC chair.
Okay.
I think we've got a problem there in that the world is changing so fast and that individuals who lead can't be wed to anything other than the track that they believe this party should be on. And that's hard to agree because we're a big party. There are many different voices. I remember when Chris Dodd was head of the DNC, and they had two people. Chris was a senator from Connecticut, very good. He was kind of the outside voice, and then there was an inside voice that was kind of the worker bee. It's a big full-time job. And so you have to have somebody that is really broadly respected. And I don't know who that's going to be and listen to, and not just another monotone.
Thank you. There's one question over here. Yes?
Hi, Senator. Firstly, thank you for your years of service. And secondly, I mean, you just talked about compromise and how, you know, over the 25 years you've compromised with the Republican Party in order to get, you know, make change. And that makes sense, except this party is no longer playing by the rules. We cannot be compromising with them. I am worried that, for instance, with the Affordable Care Act, if they try to make you compromise so that you have to reduce coverage or benefits in some kind of replacement plan. Trump is going to use that to cite bipartisanship to further, you know, push his agenda forward. We need you in this new non-politics as usual setting to actually take a firm ground and not be okay with compromise.
Well, I thought I said that I will oppose any action to repeal the Affordable Care Act. I thought I also said that I think there is a problem in one place, and that's the individual marketplace, and that we will do an amendment to that marketplace to be able to stabilize it so that you don't get 10% premium increase 1 year, 15% the next year, which you know, and it goes on like that. That's the weak part, in my view, of the plan right now. We can change that and work it out so that we can stabilize premiums over a period of time. Oh, well, absolutely. You mean be denied buying a plan? You can't deny them. This would have all the provisos that, you know, you keep your child at the age of 26 on the plan, you cover pre-existing conditions, all of those kind of strictures.
Thank you. There are so many questions that we could get into. Let's right over here. Sure. And if we can make it a question, that would make me happy.
Okay, I'll make you happy. Hi, Senator. Thank you for all your years of work in the federal government and in California. I have a question. So this new government is very scary with what it's doing to institutions and norms, and now their stated purpose of deconstruction of the government and all that. And so to get involved with our representatives that don't want to directly engage with us and don't want to have town halls, what would you suggest our strategy be?
Okay. I think young people have to prepare themselves to run for office. And you don't start at the top, you start at the bottom. And I'll tell you what my secret was. Because when I ran in 1969, no one expected me to win, let alone top the ticket and become the president of the Board of Supervisors. It's preparation. It's developing, I say to young people, develop a portfolio of expertise. For me, it was crime. I had served as an appointee of Pat Brown's on one of the term setting and paroling boards. I wrote articles. At that point, someone ran them on the front page of the newspaper when the San Francisco Examiner was the daily afternoon newspaper. That gave me a certain constituency. But crime was what I knew the most about. And so I could write, I could speak. It was all, we went out, we hung house signs, we campaigned. It's much easier now, because when I ran, it was citywide, the whole city. Now you got a small district, it's kind of a piece of cake. So prepare yourself and start somewhere. Maybe it's the school board. Maybe it's a government board of City College. Maybe it's the Board of Supervisors. Maybe you want to get on a library commission or something. Start and understand that it's a commitment to public service. I made that commitment through thick and thin. I stay with it. And you have to do this. I remember a woman, her name was Shirley Chisholm. She was an African-American member of the House. She was great. She was in the House for a short time. She ran for president. She was defeated. She quit. You don't do that. So you don't do that. You keep going. I ran for governor in 1990. I was defeated. It was, 2% difference a Senate seat opened, and I ran for the Senate seat. And here I am. And I live to be able to solve problems, which I find very exciting. Not the rhetoric as much as the problem solving. And so you learn what your strengths are, you learn what your weaknesses are, and then the key is work to your strength. But you're young, you can do it. There are all kinds of organizations that will help. And it's much easier. In my day, when I first ran, I would see people look at me and say, she must have a bad marriage. There must be something wrong with her to run for public office. 1969, before a lot of you were born. But, you know, you can. You can.
Thank you. Senator Feinstein, I want to thank you for joining us at PPIC today, for accepting our invitation to be part of this conversation, and for your leadership
in the
U.S. Senate for Californians. I want to thank you, and I want to thank everybody in the audience for being here, for your energy, for your enthusiasm, for your concern, for your commitment. I hope you will join us at other PPIC conversations and events that we will have coming up in the course of this year. We will have some of the candidates for governor will be joining us. We'll be asking them about their vision for leading California and the issues and how they view the state's future. I want to invite all of you to join us for some coffee and cookies. You've all earned it. And we really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Oh, there's a sign. Where's our town hall?